Okay, so I'll get started for our session today. Okay, where are we? We're on our homepage, rockefelleruniversity.github.io. My mask on, we're definitely in the minority. So we're on our website, rockefelleruniversity.github.io. I tried to keep up with the videos. I do need to add the exercise from last session. But we've done pretty well. We've got through our intro to R here, plotting in R, bit of reproducibility using R markdown. Kind of introduced ourselves to genomic data, the type of data we're going to handling, how we can review some of that once it's aligned in IGV. And then we've been trawling through the different objects we're going to need really to be able to handle any type of high throughput sequencing data. So now we can get started on some actual analysis using some real data, and we'll get started with RNA-seq. So as always, we need to install some things on the page. We're actually going to use some some external software today called Salmon. So this is an R. So if you've got a Mac laptop, you'll be able to follow along. If you're on Windows, you'll need to, I think, find a Linux or a Mac to actually install Salmon. But we're going to show you how to install that using Conda from inside R, with one of the packages we wrote last year. So to get downloaded material here, I realize it's a lot of material, material to download. It takes like 3.8 gigs or something. So we're going to use some real data in this, but we've also provided some sample down data. But I think we're actually going to use some of the data from a study we worked on as a team. So to get started, we'll begin with the first part. And this is really just getting us into turning FASTQ into something aligned. I'm recording, I'm sharing. Fantastic. Okay. So RNA-seq, which has been around now for at least 10 years, maybe 20, offers a method to simultaneously measure the genome-wide expression of annotated and novel transcripts. Okay, so the basic approach, 1,000-foot overview, would be you would isolate your RNA in some way using your trisol or your RNA-seq columns or whatever. Maybe, and quite often, people will use some type of poly-A enrichment here. And so there is a sacrifice. If you're going to poly-A enrich, you're going to have a lot more reads landing on genes. If you don't, you can do something like a ribo minus. You will remove the really common RNA species from your data. Be warned, do a poly-A. You're going to differentially remove quite a lot of non-coding transcripts. And small RNAs, miRNAs, piRNAs, they're all lost. And you actually need different methods to analyze them anyway. But by poly-A capture, we're really just aiming to capture standard gene expression, poly-A, mRNA gene expression. Once you've collected our RNA molecules, we then fragment and prime. So we fragment these into smaller pieces. And then we'll add primers, usually random primers here, can be poly-A primers as well, but usually random once we've fragmented. And then we'll do first strand cDNA synthesis. So we'll take a copy of the RNA and we'll turn it back to DNA, so cDNA, using some reverse transcriptase. And then we can create a second strand cDNA synthesis. So we make a copy of our cDNA. And then at that point, we can start to get it ready for Illumina sequencing by adding adapters. And once we've added adapters, we have our double-stranded DNA fragment coming from a portion of our RNA somewhere. And we'll add adapters which allow it to stick to the Illumina flow cells and actually also allow us then to sequence into this bit of DNA we're interested in. So really, it's fragment your RNA, make a cDNA copy, make a second strand cDNA, so you have double-stranded cDNA. And really, the representation of these cDNA molecules, or these cDNA molecules, should represent the RNA they've come from. And the relative abundance of these cDNA will also reflect the abundance of the original RNA. So once we have this, we go into Illumina sequencing and we usually have, say, at least one read, and that will sequence from one end into the sequence. And then we may have a second read, which will go in the reverse across the other side of the read. So at least we're going to be sequencing some of this. We may be sequencing all of it if we have a read two going on. So with all that, the common goal really is to identify genes. Chat. You know what? And I'm not really sure I've given enough of an overview of this to tell you when and where barcodes are added. So we can probably do a review at the end a little bit. This is really just meant to be a RNA being turned into CNA and being sequenced. Connie may know better. The Genome Center would know better. So a common goal of this really is to identify genes or transcripts which are expressed at differing levels. Absolute quantification of expression level of gene is subject to measurement bias. So GC bias and PCR steps, RNA capture selection, sequencing even, you're better off sequencing things with less GC, I believe. So it's actually more appropriate to compare the levels of expression for the same gene across conditions than to compare differing genes expression within one condition. So most of the time, we're not going to say confidently, gene A is higher expressed than gene B. And that's because gene A has got a different sequence, and it's actually made up of a different composition. Therefore, there may be biases which arise from any of these steps, which make them hard to compare. We will try. You can do things like transcripts per million. But more often than not, we're going to compare gene A in condition condition one versus the expression of DNA condition two. This is often called differential gene expression, differential transcript expression, or digital gene expression, digital transcript. Less frequent goal, but becoming more common, is to identify changes in a relative abundance of transcripts for a gene between conditions. So really, a gene expression, the overall expression of that gene may not change, but the transcript usage, and we can see in this example here, we have two transcripts for one gene. And actually, if we look along the first transcript, so any coverage across this, it looks fairly equal. But once we go into the longer transcript, we can see that this only has expression in one condition. Okay, so that's a good example of differential transcript usage. Whatever this transcript does, it's only expressed in this condition, whereas this one is expressed in both. So in order to kind of to cover RNA-seq, we're actually going to go through this in five little parts. Today, we're going to do alignment and counting. And then this afternoon or in the next session, we'll do differential gene expression analysis. In our third and fourth session, and probably fifth next week, we're going to talk about how to visualize this, do a little bit of clustering to try and find patterns in your gene expression. We'll do gene set enrichment analysis, that is functional enrichment analysis. And we'll end this with differential transcript usage. So I don't know if anyone, is anyone here from MSKCC? Is anyone from Leslie, Christine or Leslie's lab? Good. Well, we're going to take some of our data because it's kind of new. It's unavailable on ENCODE. It was only sequenced a few years ago. And she took some Treg data, so some T cells, and she's got them pre and post activation. And we're going to use that data here in this experiment or in the sessions. I've already made some intermediate files, and you can actually download them as well alongside everything else on that front page. You also grab them from here. And then once you've got them installed, downloaded our RNA-seq course, which should have been on the front page. You just need to change the working directory and everything's available. Okay, so FastQ, we know we can handle this using the short read package. This allows us to really get quite low level with our FastQ data. So we've already covered how we can use that. I also showed you how you can use this RFASP package. So RFASP is kind of new. It's something we developed alongside the actual FASP software to just allow you to do this in a much faster and memory efficient way than we can do perhaps with the short read package. If you want to get reads into R and manipulate them yourself, you're going to have to use short read. If you just want to get some QC so you can see how you've done, RFASP is the faster alternative. So we can download, if we wanted to, the full FASQ for this particular session from ENCODE. It's available here. You can also just go there yourself and click. And then if you want to download anything to our present session, we can just use this download.file. We give it the path we want to download. We tell it where we want to download to. Alternatively, I've already downloaded one and I've subsetted a little bit and put it inside this FASQ directory. So to run our FASP is super easy. It's just one line. We just need to give it, once we've loaded our FASP, we just do our FASP function and we give it the read we want to analyze. So here the downsampled read, the sampled reads. We tell it where we want to output any filter FASQ. So this will also output a file for us, which is an HTML, and we can just step through this. So with that one line, our FASP is going to do lots of the metrics we spent some time doing in short read. I think it's important that we know how to do them in short read so that we really get an understanding. But our FASP is going to save us some time. One thing it's going to generate by default is the FASQ file, depending on what we named it here. It's going to generate a fastq.gz, and that will be the FASQ with all low quality reads filtered out. Usefully, it's also going to generate an HTML file, which we can just go in and review. And it's also going to recreate a JSON file. I'm not sure if anyone really knows JSON here, but if you were developing your own tools, JSON is a nice file format, which is interchangeable between programming languages. So it also has that. Once we've run this, we can also just get a quick idea of some of the summary metrics just by running QC summary on the result from our FASP call. But most usefully is we can actually go and open up the RFASP report. So I've just opened up one here. This is us running it. Oh, nope, not that one. This one. And you can see it just generates a very simple report telling you lots of useful metrics. Actually, how many cycles you had, total number of reads, we've downsampled it to 1,000 here. Total bases covered, how many pass filter, so here 99%. And we can see things like the quality over the read here. So we've seen these plots before, and we can see here actually quality kind of jumped up quite quickly at the beginning of the read. We might want to investigate that. And we can also get an idea if there's any biases along the read. So here we might want to keep an eye out for whether or not we have more A's or T's or C's or G's. And as if you look at that, it looks very flat. Nothing to worry about. And we have a little bit of this at the beginning. But usually we have more A's just at the very beginning of the read. And that really isn't a problem here. We can be pretty content. We don't see big spikes of A's or G's or C's or T's. So hopefully very quickly, you can just run your report using RFASP. You can get a little bit more information here, but really just running it like this, telling it the output files you want to produce, and then just opening up this HTML will save you a lot of time. It's a lot faster than doing this in short read. And actually one advantage, I don't know if anyone's ever used FastQC. David has, I'm sure. FastQC only does 1 million reads. This will do every read in your file. So that's kind of important if you really want to do the filtering. Okay. But quite often, you know, if you've worked with a Genome Center, as you saw there, you know, actually 99% of our reads passed filtering. So we really didn't need to throw anything away. And anything we did throw away probably wouldn't have been aligned. So we're all right about it. But having got an idea that our qualities look okay, we want to proceed with the experiment. We then want to align our reads to the genome, right? And we need to do this because this is RNA-seq, taking into account our splice junctions. So just to remind us, not all reads will align contiguously against our reference genome. Instead, they will map across splice junctions. So where we see exons across our read model, for RNA-seq, we're going to get reads mapping across exons. So we need to use a splice-aware aligner. And since the BAM file should contain aligned sequences, then we can use for further analysis. So we need first to get a FASTA file we can align to. So I'm going to show you how you can get a FASTA file from our BS genome objects, which we can then use. If you have a FASTA file for your genome, which you're going to use for your analysis, you can just skip this part and just use that FASTA file. Okay, so here we're going to be working on mouse, right? So we can load the library for MM10, whatever the latest genome we want to use is. So we'll do library BS genome musculus MM10. So we should have seen this in our BioStrings lectures. I can then just type this into the browser and it will give me some information. Musculus MM10, let's do this, I'm missing some of this information. Make sure I've got it here. Someone else's work. Let's do it for HT19. They all have the same information, and what they tell you then, all the chromosomes there, we have 640 sequences, but it tells us at the bottom how we can access elements of this using seq names to see all the sequences available, and using dollar or double square brackets to actually extract the sequence for a particular chromosome. So then if we have all the sequences for every chromosome, we just need to extract them. In this case, we're just going to cycle through the major chromosomes. So chromosomes 1 to 19, the sex chromosomes, and the mitochondrial chromosome. So I'm going to create a named list of this, sorry, a named vector. So I'm going to paste cur to 1 to 19, X, Y, and M. That's going to give me something like this. So it's going to give me all the chromosome names for what I want to use. And then I can just loop, L apply. I'm going to loop through those names of those chromosomes. And I'm going to use this little function here to extract for every value of the main chromosomes. I'm going to extract an index from our BS genome object. And that's going to return to me a list of the sequences for every chromosome listed here. Once I've made that list of chromosome sequences, I can then give it the names based on what I actually extracted here. And once I have a named list of sequences, I can pass this to the DNA string set function. And that's going to create our DNA string set object here, just length 22, containing all our major chromosomes. It always looks a little disappointing that it starts with N for everything and ends with N. It's just the beginning of the end of chromosomes. It really isn't sure. These are our telomeric regions, I guess. So we're not sure exactly what's that. Okay. But this is the full genome we want to align to. So now I have that as a DNA string set object. I can just write that to a FASTA file, doing the write X string set. Give it our DNA string set object I just extracted, and then tell it the name of the file I want to write to here, ending in .far. And now I have the full genome for BS musculus MM10, so the full MM10 genome written out to a FASTA file from my lab. Again, if someone in your lab or they're already doing analysis, you may not need to extract this. You could just take this FASTA file yourself and work with that. The nice thing about using the BS genome objects is we know the TXD DB objects are going to be directly related. So annotation will be good. So the next thing we're going to do is try and align it. We have the FASTA file, we have our FASTQ, we're certain or we're sure that they look good quality. Now we need to align that FASTQ to our reference genome. So to do that, we're going to use the rsubre package here, and we'll use the subjunk algorithm. We have two algorithms available to us, align. We'll do a contiguous alignment to the genome. Subjunk will be splice aware. So it's going to find splice sites and align across them. But the first thing we need to do before we do an alignment is build the special subread index. So build index is the function for that in subread. We would usually just do library r subread, and then we could just do build index. We could give it the name of the index we want to build here, mm10 main crew. You can call this whatever you want. We then give it the path to the FASTA file. It is in the same directory, so I'm just giving it the name of the FASTA file. And importantly, on your computer, this may be, it's going to take 40 minutes at least. You only have to do it once. Once you've built the index for your species, you're good to go. But we can actually control the memory as well. So you may find you start this and it will tell you off and it'll say you don't have enough memory. This is going to go really slow. You can actually tell subread to save you some memory by specifying memory here in megabytes. So maybe just 2000 megabytes. But you also need to say index split equals true. Okay, so then it's going to build, it's going to split that index into multiple chromosomes. It will take a little bit longer to build, but it's going to save you memory, not just now, but when you come back to align against it, it will also save you memory. So by controlling the memory step here, you're not just controlling the memory used in indexing, you're controlling the memory used in alignment later on. So we can align our raw FASTQ to the new FASTA file using this package. Subjunk is, as I say, splice aware. So it's going to try and detect reads which span introns. So they're going to go from one exon to another, skip out the intron. But it may miss non-canonical splice sites. And that's because subread under the hood is using some very simple rules to try and find splice sites. It's actually looking for lariat structures. This is AGUA or something. It's a particular combination of bases we know we see splice sites around. So if we want to account for non-canonical splice sites, and human genome, the mouse genome is very well annotated now, we know a lot about non-canonical splice sites. We just need to actually provide it either with a GTF, so we should be comfortable, we know what a GTF is, contains all our gene models, or a new format, which is really just built for a subread called SAF. I don't know what it stands for, sequence annotation format, I'm not sure. So we can provide SAF and GTF as another parameter to our alignment to the actual annotation external parameter. And we need to set two additional things. We need to tell it we want to use the annotation. So we're going to set that to be true. And we're also going to tell it a GTF is false. Okay. So the reason we're going to use SAF here rather than GTF is because we're going to use the transcript models, right? So it's actually easier for us just to make a data frame of our exons and genome information than it is for us to then write out a GTF and then use that. We could do either. So SAF is used by rsubre to hold feature information. We just need a table of the exon's chromosome locations. So chromosome start, end, strand. And we need an ID, which will tell us this exon belongs to this gene or this exon belongs to this transcript. So here we're going to get this information from our TXDB package. We've already seen these. We just need to load the appropriate package. We'll do library TXDB musculus UCSC MM10 known gene. And that will extract all the gene models for this particular species, this particular build. And now we can do exons, give it our newly loaded TXDB object, tell it we want transcript ID and gene ID. And now we're just gonna take my exons, and we're only gonna keep, here I'm just gonna show you exons where the lengths of the gene ID were one. Okay. So we do have some exons, for whatever reason, have been misannotated to be members of two genes. That's just wrong, we throw them away. It's a problem in someone's annotation. So here we're just gonna filter down for exons which can only be contained in one gene. There are tons of problems with annotation. So this is one we need to just tidy up ourselves. Once we have that, as a G range is here, and it's just off the side of the screen, would be gene ID, we're just not seeing it here. We can then turn that into a data frame by doing as.dataframe on our G ranges, turns it into a standard data frame. And then from that, I'm just gonna create a slightly tidied up data frame, which is gonna have a gene ID column based on the gene ID from our G ranges. Now a data frame, the chromosome with the seq names, the start with the start, the end with the end, and the strand with the strand. Okay, so this is the data frame. This needs a gene ID column, it needs a cur column, start column, an end column, and a strand column. But we can extract that all from our TXDB object. Now we've got our SAF data frame here, ready for alignment. Okay, so now we can run subjunk. We're running it basically like we did in the Bioconductor sessions. We give it our index name, so we created this earlier. We tell it the FASTQ we want to align. We tell it the output format is BAM. We tell it the output file name. So it's going to create this file name in this format. But additionally now, we want to capture the non-canonical chromosome splice junctions. We're going to use annotation equals true. We provide the annotation to this annotation external argument. We tell it the GTF is false. And I'm going to set here n threads equals four. Okay, so that means it's going to run on four processes on your laptop. If you've got a Mac, which many people here do, you're going to have no problem running things in parallel. If you have Windows, you're going to have some problems running stuff in parallel. It's just Windows is actually caught up now. It uses very sensible systems, but they're just not built into Bioconductor. So we can't get the free parallelization. This will speed up things significantly if you're on an HPC, set this high, 20, 30 cores. Once this has produced our treg.bam, we know we still need to just do a couple more things to it. Every time we get a BAM file, we can check whether it's sorted, but in this case, I know it's not, because it's come straight out of our line now. So we sort it with sort BAM from the SAMTools library. So we library our SAMTools, sort BAM, give it the BAM file we want to sort, give it the prefix of the BAM file we want to make. So there's no .bam here. And then we just index this, because indexing means we have random access, and it's only after we've indexed we can use this BAM in IGV, and we can use it in some of our other programs. So we managed to align our file, create a BAM file, which is indexed and sorted. The next thing we want to do is some of our summarization. We actually want to get counts, summaries over our genes in this case. Right? So we've got the BAM, so we just need the quantification tool. First thing we want to do is get back our gene models, and we're going to use these for counting. So again, we've already loaded this, but we'll load it again to be sure. Library TXDB, MM10 known gene. And with that now, I'm going to extract our G ranges list of exons, so exons by gene. So let me just remind us what that looks like. Maybe I show it in the next slide. Maybe. Okay. So this gives us our G ranges list from the genomic ranges. And actually what it looks like here is for every entry, so we've just got the first two entries in this G-Rangers list we just created, but they're both named by the gene ID. This is an entrees gene ID, so it's a long number. But inside every G-Rangers list, so for this gene, we have here, I guess, 9 exons, and it's these exons which make up the gene. Okay. Notice, you know, already we can see some of the problems which may arise from counting. You can see that these two exons overlap, right? They're probably two alternative versions of the same, or two alternative versions of an exon. Right. So when we're counting, because we've kept this as a G-Rangers list, it's going to know not to really worry about reads which overlap multiple exons. It's just going to count reads which land in any of these exons associated, and then associate that count to the gene. Okay, so we don't need to worry about overlapping exons. So now we need to try and use those G-Rangers list to try and actually summarize our bounds, the reads, to give us counts over those genes. So we're going to do that by using the genomic alignments package and the summarize overlaps function. So we'll load genomic alignments, and then we will turn our BAM file, sorted BAM file, into a BAM file object. And hopefully you remember this, but the nice thing about a BAM file object is that we can set the yield size. So that means it's going to count 10,000 reads at a time in memory. Again, if you're on your laptop, you need to keep this small maybe. If you're on an HPC, you can set this to 1 million reads at a time, and it'll just be that much faster. Once we've created this BAM file, we can then just do summarize overlaps. And we just need to give it gene exons here. So this is our G-Rangers list of everything we want to count in. We give it our BAM file path. And in this case, I know, and your genomic center will tell you, I know that my RNA-seq is strandless. It can land on any strand. It's not strand specific. It doesn't only land on the positive for positive genes, negative for negative genes. So then I get my, back from this, I will get my range summarized experiment object. And we know that that contains, that was in our last session last week, that contains here 24,000 rows. So it's got as many rows as there were genes to count across. It's got one column, because we've only got one sample. It's got an assay containing our counts. So it's got all the counts over our genes. And this assay will be the same dimensions. It'll be 24,000 rows, one column. We have row names, which correspond to our gene names. We don't have any cold data, but we should have some row ranges in there somewhere. Okay, so that's how we count over genes, very straightforward. Next thing we want to do is try and just make sure we can count over exons, because if we want to count differential, if we want to start to investigate differential transcript usage, one way to do differential transcript usage is to say which exons are changing or going up or down between conditions differently to the remaining exons. So here you can say that these look pretty similar. You might say these exons are, you know, infinitely times greater in this sample than that sample. Let's say 10, 20 times greater. Okay, so being able to count over individual exons accurately is important to us. The problem is, that by counting over individual exons, a lot of exons actually look like this. Right, we have 3 exons and they all are contained within this top exon. So if I wanted to know which exon's actually being used, or I want to get an accurate measurement, I have to think about it a little differently. And one way that we can do it is by no longer maintaining this structure for the exons, but to break our exons into disjoint and non-overlapping parts. So if we look at the bottom here, that's exactly what I've done. This is our non-overlapping disjoint exons. And we can see that this exon part here actually represents reads which could come from any exon. This exon here corresponds to reads which could come from two exons here. This exon here is only from this exon. So we can start to think that maybe if this exon changed only, it's this exon which is being used differently. Right? So this is how we're going to deal with our recounting, by taking our overlapping exons and creating disjoint non-overlapping exons. We will do the differential over these, and then we will use some tool to pick apart which transcript is probably changing if this exon part is changing. So we need to use a tool here, and I apologize that actually this tool, as happens a lot to me in Bioconductor, we'll talk through it, is now called considered deprecated. Okay, so we'll talk through that as we go. So we'll use this disjoint exons function from the genomic features package with our TXDB object. This used to be a real pain to make these. You'd have to make it using Python library. Thankfully, they've included it now in the genomic features. So all we need to do is pass our TXDB object here to the function disjoint exons, and it gives us the G ranges made of all the now non-overlapping distinct exon parts. Okay. When you see this line, does anyone know what this really means? So this line here. Okay. When you see this, it's basically warning you. Deprecated is just before being removed. Okay, so all the tools we're using are community driven. They're written by people like us, and they change their minds and they decide we're going to change the name of the function and we're going to call it something else. Or perhaps we think this function isn't as useful as a function which can do multiple things. Okay. So when you see this, it's not telling you it's not working. It's a warning, but it's telling you if you keep using disjoint exons in your scripts, in a year, in a few years, it will be removed and your functions will stop working. Okay. So it's if you update R and use the latest version. So it's telling me I need to update to exonic parts and we'll update the script as well. But it still works now. Okay. So once I created my non-overlapping exons, I want to give them a name that I can then tie it back to the gene. So the easiest way to do that is to just paste the gene ID. This has gone off a bit of the side of the screen. To the actual exonic part, so the number of the exon in that gene. We're back again. And then I'm just going to give it a separator by an underscore. And we can just look at the first three. Now, these are my disjoint exons. You can see now they no longer overlap. And we have the gene ID here, but I have this combination of gene ID and then position of the exon in the gene. This was the first, this is the second. I think I can actually relate that back to this gene, which we've collapsed. So you can see these two were overlapping before, but now it's kind of created a new exon, which was up until this part. So we can see that, yeah, up until that part there, and then created the rest of the exon there. So now we can use the same counting function, summarize overlaps, with our non-overlapping exon, with our BAM file. The only thing we need to change now is interfeature. We need to set that to be false. And that's because if interfeature is true, it won't let you count reads which overlap multiple features. Okay. And actually, when we have exons right next to each other, there will be reads which cover multiple features. Right, so you can see here, I mean, it's hard to see, but say this one here, we have this bunch of reads here, which are actually both in this exonic part and this exonic part, and probably ones which span all three. We actually don't want, and we're really concerned about reads which overlap multiple genes. That's way less likely, right? But we want to throw them away. If we do that for exons, we'll end up throwing away too many. And so we're happy to count reads which overlap multiple disjoint exons. With all that, then we can start to actually review the counts we have. And we, to get into the counts, we know from our little look at the object here, we have one essay called counts. So we can actually get those counts by just doing assay on our range summarized experiment object created by summarize overlaps. And if we look, we can see the exon counts. We just have one count over the second exon here. But in this bottom one, the gene counts, we can see we just have one read allocated to the whole gene. See what else I plan to do. Okay. So that's how we can summarize gene and exon level counts from aligned data. The next thing we want to talk about is what is called pseudo-alignment or quantification. So I don't think we've discussed, have we discussed salmon previously? Maybe. So recently, in the last 4 or 5 years, through really thinking about how you index transcripts and through using clever tricks in indexing and finding unique transcript parts within your transcript models, you can actually do a very fast transcript abundance estimate without ever having to align your data. And that means I can be confident that this read came from this transcript, but I may not know where in the transcript. Right? I just know it belonged to that transcript. Okay? And this is all about indexing effectively. Right? If we don't care to place it exactly, we can save ourselves a lot of time. So two pieces of software which have done this in almost identical ways are Salmon and Callisto. And I'm sure in your own labs, they probably backed one over the other. I am going to choose Salmon. This is what we use in our thing, and it isn't because I have a preference particularly for one over the other. Salmon is better integrated with Bioconductor. But there are some good stories here, and I invite you to look up the fun competition between Salmon and Callisto. And I can tell you one thing, Callisto, I'm not sure if you know why, I guess you don't know why this is called Callisto. Do you know Callisto is the, I think it's in the sky, it's one of the zodiac, it's a bear, right? Bears eat salmon. So that's why he called it Callisto, right? Both really great software written by fantastic people in absolute competition with each other. So we're gonna choose Salmon, but I invite you to use look at Callisto too. Salmon is the latest, and it's, Kingsford Lab have been at this for a while. They use Jellyfish and Sailfish or two other programs they developed. And both of these are used basically at a low level within Salmon, but effectively it offers a transcript quantification from FASTQ and a faster file of transcript sequences. So originally we didn't even need a genome. We do now, but I can tell you this is very fast. And if we just look across some of the authors here, Rob Patrow, Carl Kingsford, they're the original. But anyone who's ever done RNA-seq will recognize Mike Love because he writes the differential expression tool that we'll use later on. And this is one of the reasons I like Sam. The author who wrote the expression tool we'll use also was an author on this toolkit. So there is no R package for Salmon. He actually came to the conference here a few years ago and we talked to him about, why not wrap this up in R? He's on it, but it still doesn't exist. So we can actually install it using Anaconda. Okay, so Anaconda is basically a method for installing a large set of software libraries. So we can actually probably have a little look at Anaconda. Can I just open that somewhere? This is Bioconda here, packages. And then it really does a great job of providing a way. If we look, say, SAM tools will be here somewhere, probably. Yeah. Effectively, biological software, it makes it very easy to install. And we have here, you can see, it will tell you what it's available on, Linux or OS X here, which is Mac. I think when we looked at Salmon, I'm not sure if it said, but I think it was just Linux and OS X, Mac. Okay, but these are kind of pre-compiled built versions of it. So you can just install it on your computer very easily. The slight issue with installing Conda for us was that, you know, it does change your bash profile. So it changes every time you log in after you've installed it, it has changed something. So, you know, our team wrote Herpa. Effectively what Herpa allows you to do is install these programs and only temporarily change your environment. So once you leave R, everything goes back to normal. Right? And that's really what we wanted to offer. So we published Herpa in Bioconductor a year and a half ago or something. So you can install it from there, BioC Manager, install Herpa, library Herpa. And once you've installed it, you should then be able to take advantage of one of our major functions, which is install_conda_tools. Okay. So if you do install_conda_tools, we just need to list what tools we want to install. So this has got to match whatever it said here. So here it's called Salmon. So we will just call it Salmon. So if you're looking in Bioconda and you want to use Herpa, whatever this name is here, is how you install it. And then we're going to put it inside an environment on our computer, and we just need to know this name for later on, called RNA-seq analysis. Okay, so behind the scenes, Herpa is going to install a very small version of Conda for you, this tool set which operates and controls the software called MiniConda. Then it's going to create this environment inside there, and then it returns to you where it has installed it. There is some complication here that because these are, you know, these are effectively self-contained tool sets that are installed on your computer, some of them you can run, just take the path and just run it. Some of them we need to kind of build an environment before we run it. I'm going to show you how we do that later on. It's just a one line. And it will basically set your environment, allow you to run the software, and then we can just exit that environment. Okay, so this is going to install it all on your computer. It's going to return the path to it, and then we can make use of this later on. So once we've installed Salmon, we then need to build a Salmon index. So far we've built indexes for various genomes. Now we're going to build an index over the transcripts. But to get the transcript sequences, we need to use this genomic features package, one we did see called extract transcript seq. Okay. The beautiful about this function is that it uses two of the objects, BS genome object here, and the TXDB object we've already come across. We just want to say additionally, use names equals true, because then it's going to name our transcript sequences by the name in the TXDB object. Once we've extracted that, we can just write that to a FASTA file, just like we did the genome, write xstring set, all txseq, and mm10trans.far is what I'm gonna call it. Interestingly, when the guy came here, so when Rob Patrow came here, they've been working on Salmon for a while, and they actually found or had discovered something which they wanted to add as a new mode. And that's this really. I mean, the theory is very easy. If we're extracting transcript sequences from our genome and then we're aligning to them, what happens is if there's a part of the genome which looks a lot like that transcript, could we be assigning sequences from somewhere in the genome to that transcript by mistake? So what he suggested then is to actually produce what they call a decoy set of sequences. Okay, and this is going to allow us to check, are we misaligning some genomic sequence from some unknown RNA expression to a particular transcript when it better belongs to the genome? So to do that, we just need to extract again. Oh, this is exactly the same as earlier. We'll extract the sequences for our main chromosomes. We'll build our DNA string set. Except now, rather than writing out just our main genomes, we'll attach together our transcript sequences and then our main chromosomes. Okay, so this is going to be a big file now, typically called the gentrome. And it has all our transcript sequences as well as all the genome. We can then, we then need to provide, once we've written this out to a FASTA file, we then need to provide a text file to try and differentiate between the transcript sequences and what is genomic sequence. And we'll just do write table as data frame, and we'll give it our main chromosomes. So these chromosomes here, write it to a file called decoy.txt, no row names, no column names, and I'll set quote to be false. Okay, so it's just gonna be one column of the chromosome names, and it's gonna go and use them as a dummy kind of background set of sequences to make sure we don't miss a line. So as with standard aligners, we need to do this indexing first. Right, this is gonna do indexing once on our genome or our transcript gentrome, and then we can use that index for our quantification. So standard command line outside of R would be salmon index. We give it the name of the index we want to create, and we give it our transcript sequences here. So to run salmon using HRPA, we're just going to first assign some names to the FASTA transcript. This is our transcript FASTA. We'll give it the path to the FASTA, the index name, we'll give it here. And then we will do our system call. So this is our system call here. And we're gonna call salmon, and we're gonna give it these arguments, index, that corresponds to here, minus I corresponds to here, index name will go there, minus T, and then the FASTA here. So that would run the actual salmon call. And then we're gonna say standard out here equals true. So we'll print the messages to the screen. In order to run this though, we want the conda environment set up. So we just put that within this with conda environment. We tell it the name of the conda environment we created five slides ago, RNA-seq analysis. Okay, so that's the environment. So we're saying to, with this conda environment, this, and we've got the closed brackets for it there, run this command, and it will run the salmon indexing, but it will make sure that it mounts and gets the environment ready based on what was installed in conda. If we want to do it with the decoy, so using the transcript and the chromosome FASTA, it's a very similar setup. We just need to provide additionally this minus D. And here it's always called decoy.txt. So I just put it in like this. And that will run it and do an RNA-seq using this decoy. I always recommend using the decoy now. This is like an updated version for sound. It wasn't available a few years ago, but it's available. Once we've got that index, if we want to quantify it, super straightforward, we can just do our FASTQ to be the path to our FASTQ we downloaded. We have our name we want to put all our output files in. And then it's the same setup again with conda-env over here, except this time now we're specifying a different index. We're specifying, I haven't got actually put the index here, but we would be specifying the new gentrome index. And additionally here, which may help you, by default, it's going to assume that you don't know whether your library's stranded, unstranded. Okay? By putting minus LA, it just automatically detects your library type. And this will run, and it will output files in this treg underscore one underscore dot. In that file then, in this directory, treg1quant, We will have log files describing what happened, all these, but most usefully, we have quant.salmon format, SF, and this file contains the name of the transcript, the length of the transcript, the effective length, which is actually what was alignable in the transcript, what's unique and alignable. And then really usefully, it has the number of reads. So that's what we would put into our further differential expression analysis. But it actually calculates the transcripts per million for you. Okay, so transcripts per million is one way of normalizing to transcript length. And this value here is the value you may use to compare different genes expression. So you may want to say this transcript is better expressed than this transcript. You can use TPM because it normalizes transcript length. So there we are. That is how we can go from FASTQ to quantified RNA-seq counts. And so in our next session, we will start to look at how we can do some very simple differential expression analysis using these counts. So we have some exercises to run through here. Let me know if you have any issues. Run our FASTP just so you can get a go at it. The alignment, and then we have an advanced section here. Download and install Salmon using Salmon quantify transcripts. That might be a good time to just look at HRPA. And then if you can't do that, you could also just review the Salmon scores here. If you have any problems installing with HRPA, I know that we just made some updates the other day. So let me know and I can show you how to install it, either from Bioconductor. It's also available on our GitHub website. So you can also install it from there too. Okay, so I'll run through this, probably the exercises at the end of the day. We will pick up the actual differential in our next session. You're welcome to stay, you're welcome to leave, but I will come back for our next session at 3:00. I know someone, whoever asked me a question about the FASTQ at the beginning, I will have you in chat here. I'll reach out to you with a better explanation. So I'll email you and we may bring Connie in to kind of explain a little bit about the details for actual when you add adapters, et cetera, to the sequence. Recording. Recording, sharing screen, and I am recording, fantastic. So in our first session today, we covered really two ways that we can quantify some way gene expression. Okay, so we looked at aligning our data to a genome and then using gene models both to assist our alignment, but also to count how many reads do we have in genes. We can do disjoint exons and find out how many reads we have across various exon parts. And then we saw we can also take advantage of this new tool, Salmon or Callisto, if you're that way inclined. really get yourself back to expression level per gene, expression level per exon, expression level per transcript. So with that, really what we're gonna do now is look at how we can start to detect differential usage of genes between conditions, both using our standard aligned data, but also our TXA, and some of the features which come with that. So again, we're gonna continue using Christina Leslie's data. I'm not picking on Christina Leslie's data, it's great data. It's from MSKCC, it's very new. And we have Treg activated and reactivated, I guess, resting. So we should see quite a change in gene expression here. We're activating T cells. We should see lots of things come on. I have made lots of intermediate files because some of these steps take a while. So if you really want to align Leslie's data, Christina Leslie's data, you can go get it, run it through the system we're doing in class, and you will get the same result. I've done it for you. so that we can save some time. So counts in genes using our subread and summarize overlaps, we can find in our data directory with genecounts.rdata. I've already saved it for you. We have counts over disjoint exons here, data exon counts.rdata, and then salmon transcript quantification output directories we can find in data salmon. So maybe I can even just quickly have a look at that. We've got salmon. We have these directories, and we have a directory for every sample. And like I said, there is other information in there, but importantly, we have this quant.sf. And if we open that, it's exactly what we read in earlier on. We have name of the transcript, the length, the effective length, the TPM, and the number of reads. There is also a ton of other information in there, and some really useful information is things like the log. You can see exactly what salmon ran. I think we also have this command info log, which is very useful. Cancel, which also tells you little bits of information, the index name, the version, the FASTQ used. There's a little bit more information than we take advantage of inside R. So first thing I wanted to do is just look at how we scale this up. So I deliberately just show you one sample, but clearly if you're going to do differential, you need more than one. In fact, you need some replicates so we have an idea of variability. So we show that we can summarize, and we'll end up with this wonderful object, a ranged summarized experiment object. We just did this with a single BAM file. Previously, we did look at the idea of a BAM file list. And all we have to do to create this is create a named vector. So we'll do that by first loading the library rsamtools. We will create a vector of BAM names. And I would have each of these BAMs in my same directory I'm in. I'm then going to assign some names to these. Right? So once I've created my vector, I'll make it a named vector by doing names and assigning some sensible names, some sample names perhaps. And then I'll pass that to the BAM file list function. And again, I'm going to say the yield size here is 10,000. So it's going to take in 10,000 read-throughs. Okay, then I just need to go get this exons by. So we can do this in a few slides, really. Get my TXDB object by loading that library, load genomic alignments, so I have access to summarize overlaps. And then I can just extract my G-ranges list of exons by gene by using exons by, and then I can do summarize overlaps, give it our exons to count over, grouped by gene, give it the BAM file list I created here, and then again, depending on whether the genomic center is doing stranded or unstranded RNA-seq for you, you can say ignore strand equals true. Okay, this then gives us a range summarized experiment where we have now five columns rather than one. So we have five samples, we have five column names, and these column names have been taken from the names I assigned to the BAM files to count. Okay, so it's carried it along for us. So that's great, and that will work in a reasonably fast way. Summarize overlaps pretty fast. But we can say here there is definitely something what people would describe of as embarrassingly parallel. And it means, you know, we can run this counting without knowing anything about how the other countings are doing. Right? There's no real complexity here. Effectively, I want to run five jobs, and each one of those jobs will count the reads from a particular BAM file, and it will count them over these gene exons. By default, though, R's going to do this, and if you're on Windows, still Windows, it will do this one at a time. Fact is, most of you on a modern day laptop have somewhere between 4 and 8 cores available to you, typically, especially on a Mac. So actually, those cores often just sit idle. But we can take advantage of them using something called here BioCPAC. Okay. So there are parallel mechanisms within R, and these include things like multiple cores, multiple machines. We can actually create like networks of machine, even within our own laptop, where we communicate between the cores ourselves. And actually, for us and for you most usefully, and we're not going to cover it here, but I'm very happy to, it's how you can use high performance computing environments. So let's say I have 1,000 files. I want to do each one of them in a different node, a different CPU. We can do all of that using one super architecture called BioC Parallel. Okay, and BioC Parallel wraps up other people's packages to make this easier for us. So we can actually control the type of parallelization by using a combination of functions from within BioC Parallel. And two we're going to concentrate on in class because they will work on your laptop, but I'm happy to talk to you about working on an HPC if you want. It's just, there's no point, you can't do that in class. is to either use this multi-core param or this serial param. So serial param, if you run this line here, it's going to create a parameter, which is basically setting your computer to run one at a time, serial. If we set here though, multi-core param, and we specify the number of workers we want to use, we can actually build a parameter here, a BioC parameter, which is now telling it to use two CPUs instead of just one. Once we've built this multi-core param here, or this serial param, we can just do register and give it this parameter we've just built, and then your laptop is ready for parallelization. Okay, so we can show you that in action maybe. So first thing we need to do is do library BioC Parallel. Let's hope I've got it installed. Okay, and then, you know, if I want to set something to be multiple cores, I just grilled my BioC param. I do multi-core, and I can set my workers here to be the number of workers I kind of want to use. So I'll set it to 2. I think by default there, have a look to see what it does by default. Multi-workers. So actually on my laptop, I have 14 CPUs. So actually 2 is probably going under the thing, right? But you can check how many CPUs are available by running that multi-core workers. And it will tell you, I have this. But if we go into the help for multi-core workers, it will also tells you by default, it will try and use all the available CPUs on your machine. So I don't recommend that. Don't let this thing take over your laptop because you are using these other CPUs to navigate your binder, etc. It won't kill it, but it will slow down your machine. I will make one more point on parallelization. I mean, here we've made it very easy. But remember, when you're parallelizing, you may be using 2 workers, 2 CPUs, but you will also use more memory. Each one of those CPUs will be trying to do that operation. So if you're going to do 8 alignments in parallel, each one will be holding the index in memory to do the alignment. So be careful quite how you set this number of cores. Start one worker. I just want to introduce quickly as well, because we're using BioC Parallel, and I think very soon, BioC Parallel will be a thing of the past, because there is now, by one of the core authors of R, one of the people being bought out by R Studio in a positive way. And he actually writes his own future system. And I can tell you this future system is being adopted by things like BioC Parallel. So I imagine the next time we do this course, we'll be teaching futures rather than BioC Parallel. For anyone wanting to really get into this, I recommend reading around futures. But here, you know, I'm setting this to be serial, but I could use this one and speed it all up. The counts object has already been made for you, so we already saved time. Hopefully, you don't need to run and align all these files and run it. I've already made a version. I've stored it in genecounts.rdata. And inside there, we have all the counts, but we also have all the regions we counted over. And in this case, I've counted over genes. So I have a G ranges list, and I have for each gene. So this is whatever that gene is. Yeah. It's this gene, whatever this gene is. XKR4. Oh, that's actually the gene I showed you for the GTF as well. That's interesting. Maybe it's first in the list or something. And then we have here all the exons for that. And then we have another gene, and then we have all the exons, right? So that's what we actually counted over. Any reads landing within these exons, we assign to this gene. So we have now our count matrix. Let's just load that to make sure we actually know what it looks like. Where am I? Get working directory. I'm in the wrong directory for that one. Yeah. Okay, that's good. And then I can do load data. Let's do gene counts somewhere. Let's have a little look. I just want to show you the. So there we have a ranged summarized experiment. This one's only one long. Gene count, sorry. Loaded the wrong one. And now I have gene counts in memory. So now we have our range summarized experiment. It's that many rows, that many columns, and the columns are, of course, the actual samples. If I want to, I can access assay. Oh, maybe it's assays. I hadn't loaded the library, so it wouldn't let me use the function. Now we have rows, our genes, columns, our samples. So now we're ready to go into differential expression analysis. So this is going to be quite general on differential expression analysis. We'll learn everything we need to know. I want to kind of keep it more generic for people who don't want to use DC2, but maybe they'll use EDGE-R, LEMA. So to perform differential expression analysis between our sample groups, we're going to need to perform two essential steps. And really, no matter what method we choose, we're going to need to perform the steps. And the first one is some type of transformation and or normalization of our counts. So maybe we're going to log transform this, maybe not. Maybe we're going to scale our counts to a total number of reads, maybe not. And then after that, we want to calculate the actual significance between groups from these normalized and transformed counts. So we need the appropriate statistical test. So there are two very broad ways of doing this. One is, used to be, I would say, more frowned upon, but has become more successful and more a method to follow with the updates of some of these microarray packages, in particular, LEMA. Sorry, I'm going to start clearing out my cache. LEMA. What? Oh, search that. Which, as I said before, is one of the oldest packages in Bioconductor. It was built for microarrays, but now has extensive, sort of one-page thing there, extensive support for RNA-seq analysis. The really nice thing about this, there's so many manuals and guides available for it because it's been around for almost 20 years now. That said, perhaps slightly more standard methods don't necessarily log, transform, normalize. They actually use the count data with normalization factors and they just adjust the tests they use, right? So when we do log transformation, normalization, we're making our distributions of our data look normal, which means we can use t-tests. count data, we can't use t-tests. Our distributions aren't normal. In fact, more binomial. So we need to use a different type of test. Okay, but we're not going to transform it that way. As with microarrays, the majority of the normalizations we're going to apply, you need to think carefully about this with your data, assumes that the composition of RNA species across samples is similar, and the total RNA-seq levels are the same. So if you're doing an experiment where you're knocking out something which stops RNA expression or lowers it by 50%, this is not going to be captured by most of the normalization and analysis methods. Yeah. It's because we're going to assume that total RNA levels are the same, and that's because we have to assume that any differences between samples is technical. Right? You sequence less for this, more for this particular sample. That won't always hold true. And there are lots of times where you'll do one tissue versus another, and you know for sure this tissue has less RNA per cell. So in those cases, you need to do something different. Spikes are involved, but most of the time we can accept that we're looking at this in a more relative way. Given that the total RNA-seq levels are the same, give me the changes in gene. I can talk about that more if anyone here is really worried about that in their own studies. There are methods to work at this. To account for technical differences in library composition, and we're not just talking absolute levels, but also the distribution in these samples, we're going to try and identify scaling factors which can allow us to normalize our samples together. So simple methods of scaling are things like a reads per million. So we will just normalize our columns of counts to make it as if they all had a million reads to start off with. Some will have 42 million, some will have 100 million. We can just divide it by the total number of reads times by a million. That's a very simple normalization factor. EC2 does something slightly different. It actually looks at the distribution of genes versus the median in every sample and tries to bring these into line. Actually, the real important detail here is that all of these approaches assume that the total RNA-seq levels are the same. Another thing which is common across most of these tools is they all try and seek to model the variance count, the variance signal relationship. And it's as simple as the lower expressed you are, technically, the more variable you seem. Lower expressed things are less stable, more expressed genes look more stable. So if we look across this graph here, and I tell you Lima does this, EDGE-R does this, DC does this. We look across here, we have the standard deviation or the square root of the standard deviation here. And we have the average log two counts per gene. And it's very clear, right? Higher expressed genes have lower variance in general than lower expressed genes. Okay. So in some way, accounting for this relationship is going to help us with our differential expression. So options for differential expression include, I'm just naming a few, MA-seq Pro, there are a lot, but DC2, probably one of the most popular. EDGE-R is also super popular. And then Voom and Lima. Lima being the actual package, Voom is the method it uses to account for this relationship. Actually, EDGE-R and Lima are written by the same people. And actually, even though we like DC2 and we're going to show it, EDGE-R is actually written by the same people who wrote the aligner subjunct. So there's a very close relationship amongst these tools. Both EDGE-R and DSeq aren't going to transform our data by log two. They're going to keep it as counts. Voom and Lima is going to log two transform our data, and then it's going to add an additional set of weights accounting for this relationship. Okay, we're not going to use Lima. The manual's very good if you want to follow along and compare. We're going to choose DSeq2. It's actually, I find it to be very intuitive to make simple. So to get started with DC2, we've got to produce a data frame of sample groups So this is going to tie sample information, a sample name, to an actual group, a condition it's a part of. DC2 contains a workflow for allowing assessing local changes in fragment read abundance between replicated conditions. This workflow is going to take care of the normalization, the variance estimation, outlier removal when you have enough samples, as well as the significance testing. It's going to take all this into account for us. So to get started with it, we just need to create this data frame. And I'm going to create a data frame with one column called group. And I'm going to have my naive pre-exposed to whatever activated these things. And then my activated. And then I need row names here. So I'll do row.names equals cull names gene counts. Okay. So that way I now have a data frame containing metadata, one column of the group information and row names here. So we can use this dseq data set from matrix function, which is the most generic way of building this. So you can come from multiple routes. If you weren't following the class, you can still come in as long as we have a count matrix. We need to provide this count matrix. Row names need to be genes, columns need to be sample names. Here we can extract that from our range summarized experiment using the assay function. We also want to bring in the row ranges. So it's not essential, they're not required, but I think it's important to have in the same object the regions I actually counted over. It's going to be very useful for attack-seq and chip-seq later. So I'm going to do that anyway. I'll assign row ranges to count G ranges. And then altogether, I can give it our count matrix to this dseq data set from matrix function. I fill the cull data parameter with this metadata we just created. I'm going to fill the row ranges with our G ranges we just got extracted from here. And finally, I'm going to say design equals, and I'm going to do ampersand. Is that what this thing is? I think it is. Ampersand. And then the column from my metadata I want to test over. So here I'm just interested in group. So I'll do ampersand group. And then that will create what is called a dseq dataset object. And you can already look at this and see it looks exactly like a range summarized experiment object. It's got dim, it's got metadata, it's got counts, it's got row names, row data, cull names. It is an extended range summarized experiment object. It's just called it now a dseq dataset. And there are subtle differences. This always needs to have a counts assay, and that counts assay always contains integers. We're going to be working with count data. As an alternative, because we already have a range summarized experiment object, we can actually just add a little bit more information to this. So the object we've already got from this gene counts object, we just need to add one more thing which we didn't have, which is the cull data, this metadata information. So we'll just do cull data gene counts. And I'm going to do $group. So I'm going to create a group column in it, and I'll assign that the metadata. Could actually do here, this is not quite what I would do. I would just do cull data gene counts and assign it metadata. Okay. Now we have a range summarized experiment object, but additionally we have a cull data element, which we were missing earlier on. So I go right all the way back here. We didn't have any cull data right earlier on. But now we've added just a little bit of metadata to our range summarized experiment object. And now I don't need to use this dseq dataset from matrix. I can just use dseq dataset because dseq2 was built to work on range summarized experiments. They want you to come from summarized overlaps. So now I have my gene counts, my range summarized experiment here. I just need to add one additional thing, which is my ampersand group. Right, so I've got to give it a design. Now it's going to rename the first element in assays to counts. I'm saying it's going to enforce that for us. Now we have a dseq dataset object, again, the same as the one we created here. But we've only needed to do one quick step, and we're back into our kind of DSeq object. Now, to run DSeq 2, we're going to run this in a very simple way. We have this workflow, this workhorse function called DSeq. And DSeq is going to do all the things we need it to do. It's going to estimate our normalization factors based on differences between library sizes. It's going to estimate our dispersions, and it's going to do that in two parts. First, it's going to estimate the standard deviation, dispersions, effectively variance. The variance for our genes individually. And then second, it's going to try and fit a modified dispersion based on the fact that we know these genes are more variable if you're lower expressed than you are higher expressed. Okay. This is kind of the trick for Lima, it's the trick for DSeq2, it's the trick for Agile. This is going to reduce dispersion, standard variation, standard deviation, which if you can reduce that, is going to improve your significance, right? Because change divided by standard deviation is usually significance. Okay, so we ran that, it did all this for us. So in the first step of this, DSeq2 normalizes our data by evaluating the median expression of genes across all samples to produce a single number, which is our library normalization factor. So it's effectively timesing our values in our columns by this factor. We can retrieve this from inside DSeq2 really easily just by doing counts, giving it our DSeq object, and we can specify either normalized equals false or normalized equals true to give us normalized or unnormalized counts. Okay, so in this case, you can see now I've gone normalized equals true. I no longer have whole numbers, because I've times these by my scaling factor. But it also means I can start comparing myself if I wanted to across samples. I could look at the expression in these two samples versus my activated samples to start to see if I can see some change. So we managed to normalize or at least scale data. The second part of this is this variance estimation. And effectively DSeq2 is trying to shrink our variances closer to the mean line across our variance. So if we go back to this one here, it's effectively drawing a mean line across here, and it's trying to modify our variances back up to that mean line. This means that we will have, when we do this plot dispersions function on our DSeq object, so what we've run through this function, we can actually see how this fit did, and we can see the fitted line in the middle. We can see our modified variance is blue. Although we pull up a fair bit, we actually reduce quite a lot on the top. And these ones with little circles around them are ones which are too far away from the line to be modified. So this should boost our p-values and allow us to detect genes which are perhaps lower expressed or higher expressed once we've modified this dispersion. Okay, so that's all done under the hood for us. We don't really need to worry about it. If you run DSeq2 and it gives you this message, you're okay. It will give you a warning or an error if it's unable to fit your data to its model. And if that is the case, I can give you some advice on your particular data. So now we've built our DSeq object, it's normalized, it's been variance fitted. We can then extract pairwise comparisons very easily. And I think we're gonna cover multifactorial comparisons later, but for pairwise comparisons, it's super easy. We're just gonna use this results function, and we will provide it with our DSeq object. And there are lots of different ways to actually specify your results. But one of the ways I find very easy, intuitive, is we just say contrast, and we give it a vector 3 long, and we tell it the column of our cold data we want to compare. Here it's going to be group, because that was the column in our cold data here. And then we will specify the groups we want to compare, and this is the, I never get this the right round, I guess this is the denominator. So this would be activated minus the naive expression, because activated goes first, naive second. And then we will have a dseq results object, which looks like this. And we can just order that the same way we would order a data frame. Here I'm going to order the p-value. So it'll be least or most significant, lowest. Okay. Just point out, we can already see an error here. If I order by p-value, and if I look at the stat, because these are all zero, it can't tell the difference between the most significant, right? And actually the stat, higher the stat, the absolute stat, the more significant it is. So this one should have been top. But the p-values are zero. And this will happen to you a fair bit in R. There is a point in R where you're so significant, we can't tell. Is it more significant than the other? It's like a number limit. But we can use the stat. So that dseq results object contains some really important information. We have our base mean. So this is our mean expression, normalized counts. We have the log fold change, activated minus naive. So if it's positive, it was higher in activated. If it's negative, it was higher in naive. We then have the, I don't know why I don't say it here, but we then have the log fold change standard error. So how confident we are in that stat, that log fold change, counting the variance like we've just seen. And then if I divide this by the log fold change standard error, we'll get the stat. And then with that stat and a distribution, and here the Wald distribution, we can get a p-value. So that's the actual significance of the groups. The final column here is something I don't think we've discussed yet, and that is your adjusted p-value. Okay, and that is your modified p-value, taking into account the fact that we've asked here 24,000 tests. So this table, this is our result, activated versus naive, and we'll be happy to move forward, I guess, with that. We can get a very quick overview about how well we did or how many changes just by using summary. Remember, summary works different depending on the object. So summary on a vector does something different to summary on a data frame. But if we do it on a dseq results object, it sets some generic cutoffs for us, like adjusted p-value less than 0.1, but it tells us how many go up, how many go down, how many are considered low counts, and I'm going to show you why that's important in a second, and then any outliers. We didn't have any outliers. We can actually review, and this is often important, we can review the relationship between fold changes and expression levels by doing this plot MA function. Okay, and if we do plot MA on our result, you can see in labeled blue here are all your significant passing this 0.1. We can see actually is that, you know, the higher expressed you got, the lower the fold change needed to actually be called significance, significant, right? And as you go here, you can see that the low expressed ones, you actually need quite a high fold change before you're considered significant. So one of the really nice, or one of the original claims for dseq2, one of the big advantages is that actually it would give you back what it described as a modified fold change. And it did this process by shrinking the fold change of genes here at this low end compared to the high end, so that you could still rank your genes by log fold change and get an idea of the significance associated to it. If you wanted to, because this got removed from dseq a few years ago, but we still have the option to actually run it. And if we wanted to, we can just do LF shrink on our DDS object. We just need to specify the coefficient we're comparing. It's a little different here. We need to specify the group underscore group one underscore versus underscore, and then the actual second group. I should have done activated over naive here. And now we can do plot MA, and you can just see that these lower differentials here, the things which had very high fold change, this fold change got shrunk. Okay. I don't think this is standard practice anymore, but what this is useful for is GSEA. So we're going to cover that in future sessions, but maybe you already know gene set enrichment analysis. It wants to take a ranked list of genes, and people used to like ranking them by fold change. I actually, and we're going to do this later, I'm going to encourage you to rank by stat, because that already accounts for the degree of change and the significance. But as a legacy, we can still do this log fold trick shrinkage. If we want to then just turn this into a standard data frame, which is what we'll need to do to write it to a file, we can just do as.dataframe on our DSeq results object. And now we have a data frame with the same information, row names, the gene IDs, base mean, log fold change standard error, stat, p-value, and then p-adjusted. Okay. If we look at this data frame where we are right now, and I haven't sorted this by p-value, we can already see that the p-adjusted is NA. Right? I don't have a p-adjusted value for this p-value. And there's a reason for that in DC2, and it's because it has done some filtering for us. So let's have a look at this idea of multiple testing. So who here has ever come across multiple testing? Nope. Okay. Good. So who here has come across XKCD? Dave? Yeah? Okay, so that's it's a very geeky little comic, but they have a great example here. So in our analysis, we tested thousands of genes. And we try and identify the significance of each gene separately at a set confidence level. So assuming that we're at a 95% confidence level, 5%, this is 0.05, very standard biological cutoff for significance. That actually means that 5% of the time, we're gonna be wrong. Right, if we have a 0.05 that this is different, 5% of those times will be wrong. Okay. If that's not so bad for one gene, but you can imagine if we're doing thousands of genes and 5% of them are wrong, we're gonna be having a lot of false positives here. And these guys have an example here. Effectively, they're testing every jelly bean to see which one causes acne. And eventually, by chance, one of these results will show a true, and it's just the chance. But you can't draw a strong conclusion from this. So we need to take into account the fact that we're testing thousands of genes in one go, and we can do that through this multiple testing procedures. And there are hundreds of multiple testing procedures, but two of the most popular, the ones you will see in papers and you will use yourself, are Bonferroni, which is very strict. More common is Benjamini-Hochberg. Okay. They're actually controlling slightly different things, but we can use either of these depending on how many significant genes you have. So Bonferroni is very easy. We just take the p-value of your particular gene, so say this one, and I would times it by the number of genes being tested, so 24,000, and then I would set the cap at 1. That's going to be way over 1, but that's how we do it. Benjamini-Hochberg is a little bit friendlier, controlling your FDR. And what this does is the same as Bonferroni, but then it divides it by the rank of the p-value for that gene. So if I go back here, and if this was in order, you know, this one would be this times the total number of genes divided by 1. The second one in the list would be that times by the total number of genes divided by 2. And this is a much less conservative multiple correction procedure. But both of these, because you're timesing by the total number of genes tested, right, reducing the total number of genes tested is going to help you get higher or better p-adjusted values. Okay. So then we need to start thinking about how can we lower this number of genes tested. And there are hundreds of ways of doing this too. One really simple way you could do is if I have a gene and I don't have a gene ID for it, or I don't know what it does, you might want to filter out those ones. What's the point of testing you if you can't follow it up functionally? And you might say, well, actually, I'm interested in novel things. I can't do that. So one of the ways, which I think is a really good way to do, or two ways, which are kind of at least independent of your test statistic, is either filtering out genes with very low expression across all your samples, or filtering out genes with very low variance across all your samples. Okay. What we can't do here is detect differential expression, filter our genes down to those which pass a p-value cutoff, and then reapply this multiple regression. That's not independent. The nice thing is that by default, DC2 does something quite clever. It actually filters out low expressed genes to assist in this multiple correction. Okay. And we can find these ones which are filtered because they are labeled NA here. And if you actually look, the base mean here is also very low. So I'll give you a comparison. These were some of our top hits, and they had like 2,000, 20,000, 4,000. If we look here, the base mean's less than one, less than five here. So these are considered low expressed, and DC2 filters them before applying its multiple correction. We can actually look in total how many values had NA. And we'll see that actually for this case, it's about half of them. 10,000 genes were filtered as low expressed. 13,000 were kept for differential expression. You may not want to apply that filter. I think it works great, but it might be that your PI or yourself, you want to have a p-value or an adjusted p-value for every gene. Maybe you've already got a study which is using every gene and you just want to merge this with that. We can actually perform p-adjusted ourselves. We don't need DC2 to do it for us. All we need to do is use the p-adjust function, which is available to us in base R. We just give it our p-values, and then I can assign that to a new column here. Then I will have additionally my new p-adjusted, but I don't have NA because I've included everything. I have one. This is not going to be very significant after multiple correction. Typically, though, when you're running DC2, you want to filter out those values which have a p-adjusted of NA. They're low expressed, we're not going to use them in the analysis. So we can do that by filtering our rows for all those which is .NA on that column. We just need to do the exclamation mark before, because we want to have those which are not NA. Then I'll order it by p-value. And finally, I can look at the top three. Now I have, I will have p-adjusted values for every single one, and they'll be filtered out to remove any which had any. We're going to need to do that for further analysis later on. So that's why I'm sharing it with you. The last things I wanted to show you are how we can then work from salmon, then how we can add, you know, instead of having that number, we can actually have a gene ID or a gene name. So we saw that in our last session, we can gain transcript quantification from FASTQ using salmon. Okay, so salmon offers this really fast alternative to alignment and counting. And if you never want to make a bigwig, never want to get alignment statistics, you kind of skip out alignment this way, save yourself a lot of time and a lot of space in your computer, and just get the quantifications. And then you can just work on them, which is really the idea behind salmon. You don't need all the components, you don't need an aligned file. They're just interested in differential gene or transcript expression, why bother? We do both as part of our course. We do both. So another nice thing about salmon is it actually is quantifying transcript, right? Whereas everything else is quantifying genes or exons. It's nice to have transcript quantification too. So we can take advantage of this salmon transcript quantifications, but we just got to summarize our transcript expression to a gene expression. So is we don't really want to work on transcripts, differential transcripts at the moment. We just want to work on genes. Thankfully, Mike Love and Rob Patrow, the author of DSeq2 and the author of Salmon, came together and wrote this beautiful package called TX Import. What's kind of nice is TX Import also accounts for Callisto. So even though they didn't write that program, they're still accounting for the other software. This is a general, whereas our track layer is our IO input output for lots of different sequencing type like files. This is our import for count files. Oh, that link. Just give you an idea. So yeah, it covers Salmon, 11, Sailfish, Callisto, RSEM, and some of you may use string time. So we need to install this package, but once we've installed it, we can just do library TX import, and we'll have all the functions available to us. We saw previously that we could just read in these files. These are just text files. There's nothing special about them. If we read them in, they have name of the transcript as the first column and then the length, effective length, TPM. What we really want is this counts column, number of reads. First, we actually need to build a map of transcript to gene. So we need to have the transcript name and its associated gene in order to summarize transcript counts we see here to gene level counts. So to do that, we're going to take our TXDB object again. We'll use the select function we used for annotation previously. We'll tell it that the key type is TX name. We'll ask it to give us gene ID and TX name back. So transcript name, but we want gene ID back. And then we're going to give it as keys, things to look up. As a vector, we'll give it the first column from our file we just read in. And that's going to be our transcripts here. We'll then get back a data frame which looks like this. I just filtered down for anything where there was an NA for gene ID. Surprisingly, there are still in the annotation transcripts which aren't associated to a gene. How that is possible, I don't know, but it is. But once we filter them out, we've cleaned up the data frame, we'll have something like this. We have transcripts here, but we can see that for the first 9 or so transcripts, they all belong to the same gene ID. And then we have this transcript belongs to a different gene. And it's this that we will use to summarize all the counts from these transcripts to the gene. Okay, so then we need to get the path to all our Salmon files. We can do that just by using the dir function. We'll point to the Salmon directory and we'll tell it we're looking for this pattern, quant.sf files. I want the full path to the file. And we're going to say recursive equals true, because that means it's just going to recursively look in the folders until it finds something like quant.salmon, quant.sf. So I should be able to do that quickly. So if I didn't do recursive, it wouldn't have found anything. Right, because it needs to look inside all these directories before it can find the quantifier. Now, salmon Q is the path to all my quantification files. And I can just use TX import on those paths. I will tell it that we're using Salmon. So if you're using Callisto, that would be Callisto. If it's Sailfish, it would be Sailfish. And then I provide to it this TX to gene ID map. And then it's going to produce the Salmon counts, which is like a list containing two really important things. It contains, and the first element of this are abundance. So these are your TPMs, your transcripts per million. So that's the value you could use to compare across genes and samples. And then we have in this another element called counts. We have the actual counts, which we will then pass into DSeq2. Okay. Notice without normalization, we already don't have whole numbers. This is because it's taken the transcript estimate. Let's try to aggregate them so we don't have full whole numbers here. When we pass this into DC2, it's going to do something really simple and just round these numbers to the nearest integer. And then that's how it's going to be used. So now we can actually, with these counts, which I've extracted here, right? So we have the salmon counts here. I can then pass that to a new function written by Mike Love, because he writes TX import, he wrote salmon. And we can use DE dataset now from TX import. And I just give it that salmon counts, the output from TX import. I can give it the metadata. I give it the design. I could have given it the row ranges, but I didn't. And then I should have then a DSeq object I can pass to the DSeq function, do the whole processing, do my standard comparisons, and then I could even just order it by p-value to allow me to start to. Checking whether it was the same top gene, but so now we could make a comparison between these two. That's a little different, salmon and summarize overlaps. Here I'm just looking at those which pass with a twofold change, p-value, p-adjusted value 0.05, but we can look and we can see the majority by a long way. So it doesn't really matter whether you use transcript quantification or feature counts, salmon, summarize overlaps and subjunct. You're gonna get very similar results. And I can tell you this, 100 in there and 100 there, they just missed the cutoff in either sample. So they weren't quite significant in the salmon, or quite significant in the sunrise. I can tell you the people who wrote salmon, Callisto, they've done some really nice comparisons to kind of compare them. The last thing we want to do with all this is just make it a little easier to interpret the results by adding some gene IDs, some sensible, maybe symbols in this case. So we're working in mouse, so we can use the org.db package for mouse for this. So we just load library org.mm.eg.db. Now we can do select. So we're going to select from this database for the row names from my result data frame, which I guess we had earlier on. And I'm going to tell it the key type of these row names is entrees ID. That's the standard. And I want to get back symbols, because they're going to be something I can actually Google and work out, or at least just look at maybe and understand. And that will give me a data frame now with entrees ID and symbol. So this entree data ID means this symbol. This is also should be in the same order as what we saw earlier on. I think I had it earlier on, maybe not. Yep, there we go. But just to be sure, what we're going to do now, what we're going to do then is merge our new data frame we just created with entrees ID and symbol to our results data frame. And for this first column, I use the first, sorry, for the first file, I use the first column, because that's where we had entrees IDs. For the results, I have to use the row names. So I do by.y equals 0 to mean row names. And I won't keep all of the annotation, but I will keep all of my results. And then I just reorder that by p-value. And finally, I have now a data frame which contains my entrees ID, my symbol, my results from my DSeq analysis, as well as my new p-adjusted value I have. Okay, so we should have got through now really a very straightforward DSeq analysis. We can go from FASTQ, use salmon, we can use standard alignment, and we can just do some very simple pairwise comparisons. Okay, so I have some exercises just to run through that now. I will be around again at 5 o'clock on Zoom to run through these exercises today. There are plenty of time to do. I'm gonna stop the video, stop the share.